We're going to get started here. So I will just start by welcoming everyone to the second of our jurors' presentations with Dimensions juror Jane Kidd. My name is Leah Moxley-Tigrobe. I'm one of the exhibitions coordinators with the Saskatchewan Craft Council. And before we begin, I'd like to note that we do have closed captions available for the webinar. If you'd like to access them, there is a closed captions button at the bottom or the side of your screen. If you click show subtitles, then you can adjust the font size as needed. They do tend to move a little bit quickly, so if you're having a hard time keeping up, you can also view the full transcript of the presentation by clicking the live on Otter AI button on the top left. It might not be in that exact place depending on the device that you're using, but somewhere there should be a little red button. If you click the small triangle next to the live button, you can click view stream on Otter AI, and then a pop-up window will come up with the full transcript for you. I'd also like to take the time to acknowledge that the land that the Saskatchewan Craft Council occupies and the land that I am on is Treaty 6 territory. This is the traditional territory of numerous First Nations peoples, including Plains and Woods Cree, Dene, Nakota, Salto, and Anishinaabe, as well as the homeland of the Métis Nation. Jane is joining us from Salt Spring Island, BC, which is the traditional territory of the Saanich, the Cowichan, and the Chemainus First Nations. We're all treaty people. All Canadians have responsibilities to this relationship, acknowledging traditional territory, and this relationship is only one of many steps we can take to recognize the land's history, challenge the legacies of colonialism, and to pay respects to the Indigenous peoples whose practices and spiritualities continue to develop, grow, and contribute to this land. I'd like to thank our sponsors, Creative Saskatchewan and the City of Saskatoon, whose support makes these events possible. Dimensions is the Saskatchewan Craft Council's biennial open juried touring exhibition of contemporary craft, which encourages and rewards excellence in handcrafted work. This year, our Dimensions program has moved online, which has been challenging for all involved, as many of you may know personally. Thank you all for your submissions. The talent and craftsmanship in the province is really incredible, and we're so proud to be a part of this program, which encourages and rewards such exciting making. Thank you to our jurors for rising to the challenge. Next week, they will be reviewing all submissions and making some very difficult decisions, selecting only 35 pieces to be a part of the Dimensions Touring Exhibition. We received 130 entries from 83 artists. Very soon, I'll turn things over to Jane, but first, if you have any questions for Jane during the presentation, there is a Q&A button on the bottom of your screen. You can click that and submit your questions there, and they will be addressed at the end of the talk. If you have any technical difficulties or concerns unrelated to the talk itself, then you're welcome to use the chat function, and we'll have staff available to give you a hand if you need it. And now I'm honored to introduce Jane Kidd. Jane joins us from Salt Spring Island in British Columbia. Her work is to be found in private and public collections, including the Canada Council Art Bank, the Department of Foreign Affairs, the Alberta Art Foundation, and the Canadian Museum of History. In 2016, she was awarded the Saidye Bronfman Award, a Governor General's Award for Visual and Media Arts, and Canada's foremost distinction for excellence in the visual arts. Jane's technically demanding and conceptually rich tapestries provoke questions about the value of skillful work and our relationship to the natural world. Thank you, Jane, for joining us tonight.
Okay, am I on now? Yeah, hi. First, hello to everyone. It's really lovely to be able to speak with you today. And as it was mentioned, I'm talking to you from my studio on Salt Spring Island. This is my first webinar where I'm presenting, so hopefully I'll manage it okay. I miss not being able to see faces and respond, but this is what we're dealing with and we'll make the most of it, I'm sure. So just before I get going, I need to just a few thank yous, in particular to the personnel at the Saskatchewan Craft Council. It's really great to work with such a professional team, and Saskatchewan is lucky to have such what seems to be such a strong craft council and so many dedicated people. I'm looking forward to next week reviewing the submissions for Dimensions 2021. I'm sure it will be a challenging week, but it's always wonderful to look at dedicated craft work. In the presentation I'm going to do today, I will focus largely on my recent work and my interest in weaving tapestries that encourage reflection on our relationship to the natural world. Along the way, I'll reference some of the research sources that have fueled my art practice for over 40 years and share my commitment to the value of skillful handwork and my passion for color, pattern, and detail. I'm going to move to a shared screen. Is that all looking good? Hopefully. Okay. Throughout my career as an artist, I've explored ideas that reference my experience of the world. And to do this, I've chosen to work almost exclusively with the process of woven tapestry. Oh. Okay, why is that not advancing? All of a sudden, oh, there we go. Moment of panic there. I find tapestry a compelling medium, not just because the process provides a means to develop content through imagery, but also because of the process itself. I've come to understand that I'm drawn to tapestry because it is an inherently sensual medium, and because the process involves the maker in constant interpretation, translation, and innovation. The making of a tapestry is also about time, the investment of time. The consumption of time through processes like hand weaving links the past to the present and provides, I think, for us a counterpoint to the immediacy and very temporal nature of contemporary culture. I began my weaving career in the Vancouver area in the mid-70s, but moved to Calgary in 1980 to take a full-time teaching position at the Alberta College of Art and Design. It's now the Alberta University of the Arts. And it's here I refined my practice and really deepened my understanding of visual art within the hothouse environment of an art college. Working in an art college environment is a very privileged position. I learned a great deal about art, about craft, my own sense of identity as an artist during this time at the Alberta University for the Arts. I retired from that position in 2011. After about 33 years, to return to the coast and now live on Salt Spring Island and work really in this beautiful studio space, which is a daily pleasure for me. For those of you who are not that familiar with the tapestry process, I'm going to give you a little brief kind of tapestry 101 on the process so you've got a sense of how my works develop. This is, an image of my studio. I work on what's called a shanak loom, which is an upright tapestry loom, which is in the Gobelin tradition. The loom is steel. It allows me a weaving width of about 8 feet. And the warp threads stay under quite dramatic tension during the weaving process. What is woven gets wound down onto a bottom beam and new threads arrive to work with. I develop imagery using source material that might be objects, photographs, found images. I draw, collage, photocopy, digitally manipulate images, write notes, all to create a composite working drawing that will help me through the rest of the process. That working drawing is then translated into a full-size, life-size cartoon. Cartoon is a traditional term that refers to the drawing that sits at the back of the loom, which is a reference to the weaver, allowing them to build their images. So this is the cartoon laid out. Once I've established the basic drawing, then probably what is for me one of the most exciting parts of the process, I start to work with the color palette. I'll select yarns that will work with the piece and start piecing together the color selection. I rarely work with just one yarn. I usually place 3, 4, 5, 6 strands of quite fine yarn together to create what I like to think of as complex colors, so that there's quite a lot of richness and depth within the colors that I work with. And I find this endlessly entertaining. I could probably just do this and not bother with the weaving process, but at some point it is necessary to actually start the weaving. After I've selected the palette of yarns, then I can start with the actual process. So you can see a detail of a piece on the loom. If you're wondering what the little metal discs are, I use rare earth magnets to hold the cartoon to the back of the tapestry, and I can slide these around as the weaving builds up and the tapestry cartoon needs to shift around. So they're quite convenient. And you can see that the image builds up a little bit irregularly. I use a very, very simple weaving process. Under one thread, over one thread, under one thread, over one thread. It couldn't get any simpler. But within that simplicity, there is room for a tremendous amount of complication, because you can make a change on every individual warp thread. I have 10 warp threads in an inch, and I could make changes on all of those threads to add detail. The process of tapestry weaving is a weft-faced woven structure, so that the colors of the weft pack down over the structural warp threads, the vertical threads, to create the solid mass of color. As you can see, I work in discrete color areas, building up the image, fitting together the forms a little bit like a jigsaw puzzle. So when you're working, you're jumping around from one shape to the next, fitting everything together. The weft ends that I'm working with go to the back of the loom. I work with the good side towards me and the ends at the back. Some weavers work in reverse with the good side away from them. But because I make a lot of decisions and change things a little bit as I'm working, that's just too frustrating for me. I need to have the good side towards me so I can really kind of judge what's happening. I like to make a lot of decisions as I work. So my cartoons are often fairly simple, and I like to manipulate the weaving process and certainly fine tune my color selection as I'm working. So I like to think I'm engaged constantly with problem solving, trying to articulate a shape, trying to create a color variation, a shading effect, constantly looking to make what could be a pretty boring process entertaining by making constant changes, by solving problems and moving ahead that way. Occasionally, well, actually quite often, you have to weave something on its side, and it just makes the weaving that much easier. So the image might be woven on its side and then turned 90 degrees after it comes off the loom. And that's just a facility of making the weaving easier. And you can see here, I have the helpful studio cat, who may make an appearance in this talk at any moment, scratching at the door. She's actually not that helpful. She leaves cat hair everywhere, but again, she makes what can be a slow process entertaining. Okay, so hopefully you've got a little glimpse into how a tapestry comes about, and I can certainly answer more questions at the end. Although throughout my practice, I'm greatly influenced by what's happening in contemporary art, I'm also aware that I have other interests, and they've taken a slightly different path than my art school training. I've always been drawn to objects from material culture, particularly textiles, particularly works that are beautiful, that are decorative, that are skillfully made by hand, and that reflect the individual or cultural context within which they were made. We're looking at a beautiful Guatemalan huipil. To pursue this interest, along with studying, I've been very dedicated to traveling, and that's become an important part of my research and practice, visiting parts of the world where textile traditions are alive, where color is vibrant, and where there's maybe a slightly different sensibility than the one that I was introduced to in art school. Pattern and color have provided an important aesthetic focus in my work, right from the beginning through to the current work. And as I mentioned before, the whole thing of color and color relationships is probably one of the most sustaining pleasures for me throughout what can be a long process in the planning stage, in the actual weaving, and in terms of responding to my work afterwards. And it is something that I hope is a hook to people who look at my work, that they are drawn in by a certain quality of color. I'm also very interested in developing detail in my images. Even in early works like this, which are fairly abstract, I'm always looking for ways within the process to create a feeling of detail. I find detail visually engaging. I'm not a minimalist by any extent, but I also believe that a high level of detail makes the composition convincing, that there is an authority that comes to the image through the use of detail. The way a novelist might add detail into a description of a place, as an artist, I feel that the detail that we create in our work creates that believability, a kind of authority, a depth of meaning. And so I'm very much committed to looking for that in my work. Over time, I've become increasingly interested in imagery, in addition to the color and pattern that has been so prominent in my earlier work. I'm intrigued by the symbolic meanings that can be conveyed through recognizable form. I'm going to just move through some earlier works where there is this more a clear combination of imagery, recognizable imagery, and pattern. And color, of course. I've also focused on ideas concerning the value of handwork. Through my practice, skill and the labor of the human hand have been a subtext underlying more overt imagery that might arouse recognition through memory or an imagination. Travel, again, has been important in fostering my deep respect for skillful handwork. In 2001, I started a series called the Handwork Series, To the Bone in the Blood from the Heart, consisted of 9 small pieces, all mounted in a framed format. The series of small tapestry, a little bit smaller than I would normally work, initially began as an opportunity for me to explore some techniques that I don't work with all that often, a way of sort of extending my technical vocabulary. My exploration of weaving processes stimulated thoughts about the value of discipline-specific knowledge and the meaning of handwork. This developed into the series that you see in front of you. That's been exhibited in a number of places, in a number of formats. And in this work, I wanted to explore the idea of social and cultural perception of time-intensive handwork and manual skill. It's another configuration of 6 of these pieces. Small, multiple works are quite fun to work with because you have a lot of installation possibilities. In the handwork series, I use images derived from anatomical and gestural drawings of the human hand and forearm. The hand has appeared in art since the earliest of human cultures and really is inseparably linked with human endeavor and the achievements of material culture. I juxtapose the body image with images that reference traditional historic textiles. Through this pairing of hand and textile, I hope to allude to the dynamics of skill and disciplinary knowledge that has fueled invention for a millennium. The tapestries are presented as fragments enclosed in an architectural frame that suggests the presentation of an artifact and possibly the potential obsolescence of both handwork and the handmade. Through handwork, I feel linked to a continuum of makers. And I'm reminded that in our contemporary culture, which is dominated by the anonymous reproduced object and the mediated and appropriated image, Handwork, handmade objects can stand for a kind of authentic experience, like other constructions that are brought to life through the skilled negotiation of handwork. Tapestries are infused with a sense of originality and authenticity. Their material presence provides a direct link to the original act of making and can circumvent anonymity for both the maker and the viewer. It's my intention to make a sense of time and the history of human labor implicit in these tapestries and to evoke reference to the long history that links material culture and the skill of the human hand. My interest in maintaining skillful handwork as a strategy in my practice, like narrative, symbolism, and decoration and color, is defined not by what handwork stands against, but by what it represents as a human endeavor. I'm going to focus now on works that explore my developing interest in our relationship to nature, in particular the relationship between knowledge and control and our very anthropocentric attitude towards the natural world. These are themes that really have dominated my work since about 2005. And I won't show you all of my works, but I'll just pick a few from the series that explore these ideas. And you'll see by now that I tend to work in a series of works. So there may be 2 or 3 or 4 or 10 pieces that explore one idea from a number of points of view. The tapestries in the possession series, one of which you see here, reference objects from material culture and the natural world. The series also examines the desire to possess and assimilate nature into material culture by translating it into decorative pattern, systems of notation, and collections. I often use a kind of compartmentalized composition in my work. Here in this series, to collect and juxtapose historic and contemporary tools, references to botanical drawings, diagrams, mapping, historic textiles. This kind of fragmented and divided approach to the compositional space for me also reflects a kind of contemporary worldview. Our understanding of the world around us is often accessed through fragmented online information, divided computer screens, sound bites, news clips, glimpses on social media. I feel we're confronted often with a kind of fragmented and often disoriented reality. So I've made this choice in a number of works to provide, to build compositions that are little bits of information pulled together that in a way reflect this kind of fragmented reality of our contemporary world. Through symbolic imagery, materials, and the labor-intensive process of hand weaving, I'm interested in calling attention to the precarious nature of our environment. The Land Sentence series, which followed along after Possession series, is about human and nature relationships. The first work in this series, Land Sentence Arbor, references land use issues, particularly the effect of deforestation, drought, infestation on the forests and grasslands in Western Canada. Through research into the human impact on the environment, in this series, I became fascinated with technological data, aerial and satellite photography that documented the changing environment. Satellite photography, scientific imagery can often provide a very beautiful, but also unnerving view of pollution, erosion, deforestation, and infestation. These images, in a way, represent a kind of disembodied technology that records the results of our often complex and often destructive relationship to the world around us. In the Land Sentence series, I've chosen to work largely with images derived from science and technology. I'm aware that these images represent knowledge, but I'm also aware that through this kind of disoriented technological viewpoint, I personally can become quite removed and disassociated from the reality of my surroundings and fail to perceive my environment with the same sense of personal responsibility. second work in this series of three, Land Sentence Pool. The second work, Land Sentence Pool, draws on diagrams, schematics, and again, aerial photographs as a source for imagery to explore our relationship to water use. The Land Sentence series is my attempt to take a scientific worldview and through the physical and sensual nature of handwork, draw it back into the realm of the personal and focus attention on the very precarious nature of our environment. The third work in this series, Land Sentence Zoo. In this case, I was researching and interested in looking at the effect of climate change and human impact on animal habitat. You know, my works are never very explicit. When I say these are the things that I'm researching, that I hint at them. I'm not really interested in being explicit with my imagery. I like to provide clues and hints and hope that there is enough visual engagement in the work that people will start to piece together ideas. And if they don't connect to the same meaning that I have, that's fine too. I think there are always little bits of information that can be picked up in the work, that can draw the viewer in, that can stimulate the idea of interpreting and trying to decipher what the artist is after. A sentence is a basic unit of communication, a meaningful statement. In this series, sentence can also reference the punishment imposed by mankind on our environment. A solo exhibition of some recent work under the title Curious traveled across Canada in 2017 and 2018. The work in this exhibition reflected my increasing interest in the use of technology to manipulate and engineer our environment. I was particularly interested in the idea of the post-natural, the idea of a world after nature encompassing artificial constructed organisms. This is the entrance at the Textile Museum of Canada. And again, I've worked in a series here of six pieces, smaller pieces that explore this idea of artificial constructs, organisms that are unnatural. The title of the work is Curiosities. We're going to look at pairings 1 through 6. Recent advances now provide the means to disrupt evolutionary biology, altering genetic material to create genetically modified organisms, clones, hybrids. For a layperson such as myself, these developments are both intriguing and disturbing. And in many ways, this is the way I find much of contemporary science. There's so much possibility, but there's also an edge that is sometimes quite disconcerting and difficult to grasp. In the Curiosity series, pairings 1 through 6, I've taken on, in a way, the role of a kind of pseudoscientific collector, in some ways akin to the 17th century collectors who searched the New World for wonders to house into cabinets of curiosity or wunderkammer. I've created contemporary curiosities, carefully woven hybrids which join two distinct entities, pairings that combine sometimes human, animal, plant, or mechanical images to create an anomaly, something that would never exist. I see these works as a kind of scientific artifice, engineered aberrations of the natural order. They are disturbing, but they also offer seductive possibilities. And in this case, the pairing number 4 is a turnip that can also grow pea pods. So again, maybe be able to engineer a plant to do more than its natural tendencies. And pairing number 6 is the bone structure of an alligator with the human pelvis to build a kind of drone-like object that probably couldn't do anything but hop. But again, can we construct other entities to possibly do our work for us, repetitive work like tapestry weaving. Okay. I think the oddest thing about doing a webinar is that there's just no way to gauge response. So I feel like I could just sort of rattle on here. But anyways, I'll try and stay focused. And hopefully at the end, I'll be able to converse with some real people out there. Three tapestries in what are referred to as Wonderland series were also included in the exhibition Curious. These works continued my exploration of concepts relating to technology and the transformation of the natural world. Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland hovered in the background of my thinking about this work. At the time, I was listening to CBC Ideas, a particular program about Lewis Carroll or Charles Dodgson, while working on this series. The ideas threaded through Alice's adventure seemed to reference the conundrum of a world upside down, or things not being as they should be or as they once were. Carroll's vivid imagining and creative approach to framing his experience of the new science and technology rapidly transforming his Victorian world reflected my own curiosity, skepticism, disorientation in the face of a world being transformed by new technologies. Curiouser and Curiouser number one continues my interest in genetically modified and engineered organisms. The tapestry reads from left to right. The images invite thoughts on seeds and seed germination and genetic manipulation. The final image of a wheat plant with enlarged grain heads is flanked by text based on GM coding for genetically modified seeds. The end of the tapestry is rolled from view, suggesting something that is hidden, unknown, future consequences, possibly. Curiouser and Curiouser number two, again, considers the effects of herbicides on our environment. The work begins with a barely visible chemical formula for two widely used herbicides, then unrolls to expose a dark and shadowy abstract landscape and silhouettes of dying plants. Near the end of the work, attention is focused on the image of a mutated three-armed amphibian skeleton and a tattered fragment of a butterfly wing. These images suggest the dangers posed by agrochemicals leaching into the watershed, linked to abnormalities in amphibians and pollen that may contain bacterial toxins. Through these works, I hope to pose questions about our relationship to nature and to the sustainability of our future. And I would say at this point that I'm not a scientist and I'm not making documentaries. My works may fall into the realm of the political and explore current subject matter, but always my approach is personal. It reflects my own confusion, my own uncertainty in what I find to be an increasingly bewildering world. And I certainly am not trying to tell anyone a particular way of thinking. I hope just by sharing some of the things that I'm concerned about and puzzling over that I might draw people into a kind of conversation with the work and a point of consideration. I find myself, as I watch the news and look at what's happening in the world, I find that I'm wondering if what we will create will solve our problems or will we create new ones? Are we creating a future wonderland or, as Alice was, will we be trapped in at least a temporary nightmare? Most of the tapestries in this exhibition, Curious, were mounted, as you saw, on wooden shelves or lectern-like supports. I did this to emphasize the presence of the tapestry as an object, almost suggesting something that would be in a museum display or a collection. Folly draws on the odd, unnatural, or manufactured quality of decorative design, but it also suggests something playful or outlandish. I worked with an uprooted tree image, floating in space, and incongruent foliage, a kind of engineered botanical fantasy. The work actually references also a particular historic textile that was produced in India, which was very, very decorative and used this sort of wild mixture of plant forms. The textile was an export textile to Europe, and it sort of represented this fantastic view of what happened in India, that the European view of this really out of control abundance that wasn't really based in reality, but was a kind of fictionalized version of the landscape there. Okay, where was I? The work is divided into two panels. The dark and shadowy panel on the right side of the work is derived from microscopic images of plant cells, the level at which genetic modification takes place. This dark and foreboding colors for me acts as a kind of foil to the more decorative tree image, suggesting a shadowy reality underlying the vision of the leafy tree. Folly hovers between the joy of imagination and the fear of pushing science and technology too far, creating organisms well beyond the realm of natural possibilities. Okay, another series. Phenomena series consists of four works. And it explores landscapes in crisis due to the effects of increasing dramatic weather events. Each work consists of two sections, a symbolic landscape that is defined through color, pattern, and stylized imagery. These areas are contrasted with a lower or sidebar section that contains more finely rendered images that represent the results of changing climatic phenomena. Dry, let's go back, contrasts dry seeds extracted from a parched and unfertile landscape. In wet, images of toxic mold and bacterial growth underlie the flooded landscape. Melt, the bones of endangered animals provide testament to the effects of a changing northern environment. And burn, the understory ecosystem emerges charred and exposed in burn. Once the sign of regeneration of the forest, the intensity and frequency of recent fires may now inhibit the natural regrowth of the forest. In this series of four works, I disrupted each one with a kind of grid structure. You probably noticed them in the works that cover in at some point in each piece. The color system of each grid is drawn from the colors of one of the other tapestries in the series of four. I did this to connect the four pieces together to suggest a kind of linking between the causes of this kind of phenomena, and also to impose a more human-centered kind of pattern, a grid pattern, which again is maybe almost like a fingerprint of human influence within those environments. Okay. I think it's always important to try and take risks and explore new approaches in your work. And I've tried to do that through my work. And I'm trying to do that particularly now in the sort of latter part of my career. And this may seem a bit incongruous for somebody who has who's only worked with one medium, woven tapestry. But I think that even when you work within a box, like within a particular approach, a particular technical approach, it is still possible to explore, to kind of poke into those dusty corners of that box and find and look for new ways of working. And in my maybe fairly subtle ways of doing this, I've tried to always extend my work to look for new subject matter that I'm interested in and ways I can draw it in, and to look at some new ways of working. As I mentioned, I'm interested in taking risks. I'm interested in finding, putting myself a little bit on the edge. And I've also become very intrigued by the possibility of the sculptural potential of tapestry and finding ways to link shape, the shape of the work, whether that's the physical structure of the work or the drape of it, the installation of the work and the imagery to build content so that it is with these works which just hang on the wall. I'm interested in finding ways of developing pieces that maybe come off the wall and where the actual shape and form will build the content. To do that, I've recently been working on two series of works that explore this approach. These are two ongoing series. Nothing is Indifferent to Us is one series, and Who Shall Inherit is the other. So I'll finish the talk with looking at this new work. And I have some things to say about the work, but I often find I can talk much more about works that I've had around for a few years as opposed to the works that I'm currently working on. But I'll try and share some of my thoughts about this work with you. As I've mentioned throughout this talk, I'm really interested through my work. I feel pretty committed to creating a space to encourage consideration of our relationship to the natural world. As a society, I feel like we sometimes seem caught between a fear of impending environmental disaster and our own inability to recognize our complicity in the cause of these events. And this is what sort of spurred my thinking in this series, Nothing is Indifferent to Us. Hood, which is the work you're looking at here, side one, is shaped like a hood, side two. And in this series, Nothing is Indifferent to Us, I employ the natural drape and structure of woven tapestry to create dimensional objects that allude to garments. The imagery is drawn from aspects of the environment. Hood pieces together patterns from the skins of endangered amphibians with this. And again, the garment references are subtle. I think they suggest a garment more as a garment as sculpture as opposed to actually something that you could put on, although you can put this on. But I'm using the reference to the garment to really draw the human body into my thinking. Veil, another work in this series, explores the effects of industrial pollution, acid rain, and the resulting environmental damage. The work is two-sided and draped over a metal bar at the top. The draped front panel, which has a kind of stylized acid rain look and a fish kill image. And then underneath that, rusted metal. This more or less obscures the back panel, which is images of smokestacks and smoke and pollution, so that you have to sort of peer around the work to see the back image that is veiled or hidden from a very clear view. And Mantle, another work in this series, which stands about life size so that you could actually almost slip it on. And in Mantle, I'm looking at ideas of the acidification of the ocean and the effect this has on coral and ocean plant life, side one and side two. I've interpreted the imagery for all of these pieces through pattern, emphasizing the decorative as an embellishment of the garment. My intent is to link the tapestry to a garment, suggesting an object that could be worn, placing the human body at the center of the circumstances of our changing natural world. So this series is ongoing and I'm looking at some other pieces. They present lots of finishing challenges, but it is interesting to take the tapestry off the wall and to let it function within in space. And I am intrigued about the idea of the reference to the garment. So that is an ongoing. The other works that I'm also currently still exploring is this series, Who Shall Inherit? And right now it consists of these three works that you see here, which I can show either as a group or singly. And it continues my interest in the drape of a tapestry object. And it's again a reference to garment-like shapes from a very, from a sculptural point of view. They can't be put on, but they do suggest sleeves, body of a garment, and other kinds of aspects of the garment. This is gown, who shall inherit gown. Each work creates a kind of symbolic reference to a garment and is decorated with patterns drawn from a particular stressed environment. We've used pattern in decoration and sort of in the history of decoration. We've always looked to the natural world to create decoration, amazing things. So it was intriguing to me to look to our current natural world, particularly a world in stress, and use decorative, you sort of create the decoration on the garments using those stressed environments. So in gown, it's a cutaway of a stratification of the earth from an open pit mine. In cloak, I was looking at the effect of desertification and drought in various habitats and used that as a means of creating decoration. And in jacket, I was looking at tar sands and oil field development and used that to create a pattern, as well as the feeling of spilled oil, patterning of spilled oil. So that I'm following the tradition of decoration from the natural world, but turning to environments that maybe we wouldn't think of as sources for decoration. In this series of works, the object of garment that you're looking at is child-sized. They are quite diminutive, suggesting in some ways a legacy of a kind of uncertain future. So not adult-sized, but based on the size and scope of children. Okay. Within my approach and practice, I employ handwork as a human-centered activity that embraces risk and invention to create the potential for originality. I value skillful making as a means to connect to skillful thinking and disciplinary knowledge as a link to history and the tradition of makers. I'm willing to invest in hand processes as a way to pay attention and to focus attention on the issues that I care about. My work reflects the complications and the contradictions of the issues that we live with, but ultimately I hope my tapestries will be seen as objects of expressive and sensual beauty that celebrate the handmade and encourage reflection on our ever-changing world. Thank you. I'd love to be able to now actually listen to some questions and know that I haven't just been talking to my computer screen. And seeing my own face bobbing up and down there. So I'll hand this back now to, I guess I should stop the screen share.
Thank you so much, Jane. I promise we were listening the whole time, although it doesn't really feel like it. And I realize now it may have been a bit unreasonable for us to request that you discuss your practice with us in less than an hour, but we do want to get a chance to address some of these questions. So I'm going to hand the mic over to my colleague, Maya Stark, and she'll be facilitating our Q&A period.
Okay, I've talked a bit longer than I thought, but okay.
Hi, everybody. My name is Maya Stark. I'm one of the exhibitions coordinators. Thank you so much, Jane. That was phenomenal. I really wish that you had been able to see my face, because it was going, wow, oh my gosh. And whoa, so beautiful works. And thank you so much for describing your practice to us. We already have quite a few questions in the chat, so I think I'll just ask them of you in the order we're getting them. So Steph asks, there is a strong relationship to nature and sustainability in your work. Are the types of fibers and their source an important consideration for you?
Oh, that's an interesting question. But my works are mainly wool, which is a sustainable fabric material, I believe. I do use some synthetics. It's not something that I can't say I'm really committed to that. It's maybe something I should think about And it is interesting. I don't use recycled materials. I have colleagues who use recycled materials in their work, but they just don't have the same quality of color and surface that I seem to need in my work. So that might be a little bit of a compromise in terms of my my focus on sustainability, that I do use new materials. I use quite luscious materials. They are largely natural materials, but they are not recycled. So it's definitely a consideration, but it's not something I can quite move into at this point.
Great, thank you. Over the course of your teaching career, this is from Vivian. Over the course of your teaching career, you have seen the explosion of digital communication and its influence, Instagram, Pinterest, Etsy. Now with the pandemic, digital connection has become even more important. You say you find it chopped up and fragmented. Do you feel this will influence the next generation of craft artists, positive or negative?
Oh, it's almost impossible to say. And I think what seems chopped up or fragmented to me may not seem so to, say, someone of your age. I think there is a generational switch or slippage here. Things that I'm not as comfortable with are much more fluid and familiar to, say, my daughter's generation and certainly younger people. I think I'm not quite sure how it will influence craft or craft production. To me, making things by hand and sharing that kind of sense of individual communication, hands-on communication between the maker and the user, would seem to be even more important in an era where digital work is becoming so prevalent. I think people will be looking for ways to connect to what I think of as a kind of authenticity of experience. But again, I'm constantly aware that my understanding of the potential of the digital world is very limited. And I think this is always to do with my age. I don't see the potential in the same way as somebody younger. So I'm hesitant to say one way or the other. But I do feel that the idea of making things by hand is a universal experience, and that it is something that's wonderful to share and experience, no matter how digital and remotely spaced our world becomes.
Absolutely. I feel like when things become very digital, there's always people who then ache and try to find those handmade things. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel like there's little resurgences. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nicole says, thank you for sharing your beautiful work from across the years. Can you please explain the value of creating your works in a series over individual pieces?
I think, I've always worked in series. I don't know, maybe I'm just takes me a long time to actually work through a composition, or once I start with an idea, so many other things about that idea seem to unfold, so that I feel like I want to do more and more within that series. It's just the way I work. I don't think it's necessarily better or worse. It's a personal kind of decision. Maybe it just takes me longer to work through an idea. Now, I mean, one series can take several years to complete. It's, you know, a tapestry slow, so it's not something that happens quickly. But it's just the way I like to work. And it does allow you to kind of do a deep dive into the subject matter and look at it from a number of different points of view. But it's just the way that works for me. I maybe think of my ideas slower, and it takes me quite a while to move on to something else. So the series is just a comfortable medium, a comfortable way of functioning for me.
Very thorough. It feels like you talk about investigating it from different perspectives. I think we as the audience really feel that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Steph says, it's going to be challenging judging works online. Do you feel ready for the experience?
I have done a fair bit of jurying with online images, Canada Council and so forth. You're always looking at online or digital images or projected images. You're rarely handling the actual work. I think that's just a a reality. All the work can't come into one location, and unfortunately, I mean, the ideal thing would be, of course, to be for the jurors to be able to see the works and respond to it in a much more physical way. I'm always apprehensive about jurying anything. It is, I think, jurying is always laden with biases, and even though you try and see things objectively, that's nearly impossible. But I've looked at lots of work. I've certainly looked at lots of tapestry. I've worked in an art school environment. I've dealt with many different ways of working. So I feel pretty comfortable with it. And I feel that we are used to looking at images of our work in a digital format. I think that's a very familiar way to work. And in fact, sometimes with my own work, I don't feel I really see it that well until I see it on a screen. I think that we are sort of trained to see things that way now. So no, I'm not too worried about, you know, looking at work digitally. I think that's a familiar thing.
Okay, excellent. You have a gorgeous studio space. I'd like to know what a day in your studio is like for you. Do you have long days? Do you tend to break it up?
I need to usually have about 5 hours to focus. Tapestry is not a great thing to just do a little bit and then go away and do a little bit more. And it takes, it takes me maybe an hour to sort of get into things. So yeah, I mean, I might leisurely come into the studio at about 9:30 or 10, cup of coffee in hand, and start working. If I've got a piece underway, I might work for 5 hours. You know, I try and take some breaks. I stand up and move to another part of the room to wind bobbins or whatever. 5 or 6 hours is about it. I think I have quite a good ability to focus. So time goes by quite quickly once I'm into the piece. And as I mentioned, I manipulate things quite a bit when I'm working. I solve a lot of the problems while I'm weaving. So that's quite engaging. And I can stay focused that way. When I'm not working, I'm just like to hang out in the studio with the cat and work on drawings or do research or whatever,
Okay, excellent, thank you. Kimberly says, Jane, your work is beautiful. I was amazed at the detail. Thank you for sharing. My question is, how long would it take you to make one of your large tapestries?
Yeah, that's a tricky question. I think, you know, like I said, let's say a piece 3 by 4 feet might take 3 to 4 months to make. But again, it depends on the amount of detail. Like something that's very complicated, you know, could take longer than that. You know, if it's got a bit larger, more straightforward areas, it might take less. But when I was teaching, I probably only made one work a year. Now that I'm not teaching, I maybe do 2 or 3 works a year, maybe depending on the size, probably only 2 works a year. I don't think I spend any more time in my studio than a colleague who paints or works with another medium. It's just my output is quite small, which is fine. I don't mind that. It's just, again, the way I work. But it is a slow process. But you know, most of you are working with craft. Craft is a slow process. It is often about taking care and taking time with things, and it might drive someone else crazy. But it's the slowness of the process works quite well for me. So yeah, it varies. The amount of time varies, but yeah, I rarely could finish a piece in a month. You know, it's usually a several month process.
Gotcha. Thank you. We have 2 questions left. I'd just like to say, anyone who has a question burning in their mind, now's your time, because I think we just have time for a few more. Heather says, with your garment pieces, do you work them flat and then construct the sleeve, or do you manipulate your frame?
No, I work them, I weave them flat, shaped and flat, and then construct it the way you would maybe construct a garment, except that they're not actual garments. They don't have 2 arms and so forth. But there's already enough logistic problems constructing them that actually trying to shape them, other than a sort of perimeter shape, to actually make them 3-dimensional on the loom would be a problem. So they're flat, I construct them, And then I work with the drape of them. So usually off a hook or something that would allow the tapestry not to not stay flat, which is usually what you want, but to fall with the natural fold of the textile.
Okay, thank you. So we have our last question here. So a last chance, everybody, if there is a question. And we do have another question. Okay, two more questions, Jane. Thank you. Cease asks, how do you maintain your enthusiasm for the subject matter / theme over such a long period of time? Does altering help?
Does what help?
Altering?
I'm not quite sure what that means. Mm-hmm.
Cease, can you pop into the chat a bit more context for your question?
In terms of maintaining my interest, I mean, there are points when for sure the process gets really boring, and particularly if there's a color area where there's not a lot of change happening. I can get really frustrated, and then I've got to get books on tape and things like that happening to kind of keep me entertained. But when there's a lot of detail and I'm making lots of changes and so forth, I find that really quite engaging. So I can maintain my focus and stay quite engaged with the work. And I think I'm quite good at being able to envision how the work will develop and to feel quite committed to the end result. So that sustains me through the process. Did we get anything back about the altering?
Yep. So she means changing ideas from your original theme as you work.
I would say that I rarely change the theme. I'm usually pretty clear about what the idea, the concept, but I might change how I present it or interpret it. I might change the colors, the shapes, the image, the pattern, the amount of abstraction, the amount of recognizable imagery. So I might be manipulating that. And it is, I mean, sometimes when I'm working on an idea, something else will come in and I might modify it. But once I start, I'm usually pretty dedicated to the idea. It's just the way that idea evolves and develops and sort of exposes itself that might alter a little bit as I'm going. But I'm pretty committed to the idea.
Okay. Go ahead.
And I spend quite a bit of time working on the ideas, through drawings, but also through notes. My drawings are probably more notes than they are actual beautiful drawings. I'm not a beautiful skilled drawer, but I write notes to myself about what I'm thinking about, sort of the layers of the idea. So there's a constant narrative quality about the idea.
Fantastic. Thank you. There's a question that showed up in the chat. So maybe, I'm just going to ask that one. Who is this? This is Dale asks, could you comment on the Salt Spring Island art competition?
Oh, snap. Okay. A little bit. I would love to see more people from craft background entering this competition. It's quite a going concern here on the island. It happens every 2 years. There is some dedicated funding for prizes for works. They bring in a really well-respected jury of four individuals from across the country. And the work is, of course, looked at digitally and selected for the exhibition. The fourth one will happen this fall. I think you have until the end of May to submit to it. So you can go to this Salt Spring National Art Prize. Just Google that. That'll take you to their website and their entry information. And so far, it has been fairly diverse in terms of media. In things that we might traditionally think of fine art, as well as works within craft disciplines like ceramics and textile. Textiles have actually done quite well in the exhibition. There've been some beautiful textiles. Anatoma had a piece in it 2 years ago, beautiful piece. The work comes from across the country. There is diverse in terms of media. Probably works that, in terms of craft work, works that are fairly conceptual might do a little bit better, but it's hard to say. But I really would encourage, if people are interested in that kind of juried exhibition, which doesn't appeal to everybody, that it is a good one to enter. They do a catalog. There is money for prizes, so which is always good, desirable. So yeah, Palm Springs National Art Prize, look it up, Google it.
Okay, yeah, you know, maybe we'll pop the URL into the chat in just a moment for that so people can find it easy. Okay, and then let's, as our last question for the night, Steph asks, is there one piece of advice that you'd like to give to those emerging and early career craftspeople?
Oh, geez, since I don't teach anymore, I don't have that much contact with early career people. You know, I think that, but I do think there is a lot to be said for just sticking to it. And I mean, I think you need to be aware of trends in the arts. You need to certainly, you can't be naive. I don't think that exists anymore. We don't function in a vacuum. But I do think you need to be true to yourself. So, you know, if there are things that are really appealing to you in terms of the way you work that aren't part of the current mainstream in terms of art making, it's good to stick to that, but to find ways of talking about it and framing it and presenting it so that it can stand up in the wider world. Nobody really likes art speak, but to talk well about your work and to present your ideas, it doesn't have to fall into that craziness of art speak. It can be just convincing conviction about what it is you're interested in, where you're going, and that might have a lot to do with function and the value of function. It may have to do with decoration and the history of decoration. I guess I would just encourage people to pursue what they're interested in, but in pursuing it, to research, to understand it, to try and come at your work from multiple points of view so that you're knowledgeable and you can represent it well in the real world.
I think that's great advice. Thank you. All right. So I feel like that's probably our last question. I'll pass things back to Leah. Thank you so much, Jane.
Oh, it's been a pleasure, and I really wish I could have more contact with the people who are out there, but I hope it was worthwhile.
We're getting lovely comments in the chat. We'll send those to you.
Okay, that's great. Okay. Well, goodbye, Saskatchewan.
Yeah, I want to just thank you again, Jane, for all of your insight into your practice. And a thank you to everyone for tuning in this evening. I'd also like to just quickly remind everyone that we are having a virtual open house that will be live from April 19th to May 2nd. And we'll just pop that link into the chat here for you. And also a virtual critique with Jane and our other juror, David Freeman. That will take place on Saturday, May 1st at 2 p.m. And we will link that in the chat as well. So thanks again, everyone, for joining. And hopefully we'll see you at some of our follow-up events happening.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.